Matt Olien in for John Harris on this edition of Prairie Pulse. My guest today is a friend and colleague, Greg Carlson. He's the Director of Film Studies and Media Activities at Concordia College in Moorhead. Greg, thanks for being here.
Thanks for having me.
You're also a film reviewer in town. We'll get to that, but just tell folks a bit about yourself, your background, and how you got to Concordia.
Well, I did my undergrad at MSUM, then MSU, under Ted Larson, who is the professor who kind of inaugurated film studies in this region, and I focused on film and telecommunication, and one thing led to another. I guess I didn't set out to be a professor originally, but I kind of found my way. All my family are educators, so I think it was partly in the blood, maybe.
Mm. And you direct films, too. You've had some films in some competitions here in the last few years that have done quite well.
Yeah, the International Documentary Challenge is a competition that sees up to 300 teams competing in a short form. You have 4 days, 5 days to make a 4 to 7 minute long movie, and we've had some success. We've been in the top 12 finalists 4 years in a row.
And you're also an organizer of the Fargo Film Festival. You and I have been at this a long time, and that's exciting too.
It's one of the best community events we have, and I know Emily does a great job. When Emily Beck, the executive director, is here to talk about that each year, I'm always happy to trumpet it as well, and I know you are too.
Yep. Okay, let's get to some media, TV, movie issues. Let's start with net neutrality. Mm-hmm. That's a word being thrown around, and I find a lot of people have no idea what it means. What is it? Why is it important? What's going on right now?
Well, I think the term was coined in 2003 by Tim Wu. He's a Columbia professor. And it's just really the idea that there should be an open internet, that providers of services should not be allowed to make decisions about bandwidth or, you know, being able to throttle content. That it's kind of the, I guess the analogy that gets used a lot is the dumb pipe analogy, that our you know, when you have water, like any utility in a city, you don't know who's using the water, how much it's available, and it's going to go through those pipes no matter where you are. So the notion is that net neutrality should preserve anyone's ability to access the internet, and have, no matter what the content is that they're looking at, it shouldn't be determined by a provider whether or not that content is allowable. And further, that we wouldn't split into small packages different tiers of payment. So if you wanted to watch Netflix, you'd pay more, for instance. And that's the reality that we might be facing if the Obama era protections go away.
Where do you see this going?
Well, it's hard to say right now. I mean, there's the poll that came out just this week by the University of Maryland suggested that more than 80% of Americans favor retaining net neutrality. And even only one in five Republicans would like to see these net neutrality rules go away. So it seems like there's an overwhelming groundswell of support for retaining net neutrality, but the current FCC chairman, seems determined to try to, you know, remove the protections that are currently in place.
Okay, let's move to how people watch content. Hulu, Amazon, Netflix has transformed how people view streaming. Talk about this transformation, how it started the last 5 or 10 years, and the impact.
Well, yeah, it's been a tidal wave of a move away from physical media, and there's certainly good and bad. Some people would say it's the best time to be a consumer of media content, digital content, because you have a smorgasbord of opportunities to look at stuff. On the other hand, film historians might say, but think of all the tens of thousands of movies that are not available. You can't just press a magic button or type in a title and know that you're going to be able to track it down. I know you collect rare movies and have to curate that collection. And so I think that's the good and bad of it. But I for one am delighted that I can, you know, open Netflix and choose a movie and press a button and there it is.
What's been the impact on cable companies, TV networks, movie studios?
Well, you know, in some sense now, Reed Hastings' model at Netflix is that, you know, you can create a new movie studio. Netflix is in some sense, it is functionally a movie studio when it's starting to gather Oscar nominations, for instance, for its content. And as we were talking about before the show, these platforms are attracting huge numbers of Emmy nominations and wins now. So I think that there's some pressure on the traditional way that we think about studios and networks by all this, you know, all this digital transformation that's taking place.
And were the studios and the networks slow to respond to this? It seems like they were a little bit.
Yeah, maybe so. That's a tough question that I'm not really sure I have a great answer
for. We're not in those meetings.
It's
right?
Not. Yeah, and so. I mean, everybody's chasing a hit, and if it's generating revenue, then you can use it to, you know, expand into to produce the next potential hit show.
Mm-hmm. Talk about binge watching. What is it, and how has this transformed TV viewing as well?
My students binge watch all the time, right? Yeah. The idea that you would an entire season, for instance, rather than parceling out the shows one per week over the course of 15 weeks. They're all available. They're dropped, dumped on one day, and so you could just spend the next 48 hours, you know, just kind of watching them all in a row. And a lot of people enjoy that. I think one of the interesting dimensions of that question speaks to the way that we think about longer form content. That some of these things that are episodic and serialized they wouldn't be able to play in a movie theater. You know, you wouldn't expect a person to sit for 15 hours in a movie theater, but you might, you know, over the course of a weekend in the comfort of your own home, easily watch that, consume that much stuff. I personally don't binge watch. I limit myself to one. If I'm watching something that has episodes, it's only going to be one per day at maximum. So I just watched She's Gotta Have It, the Spike Lee series on Netflix, and I could only do, you know, one per day because I like to think about each episode a little bit.
Yeah, I'm like you as well. Is this the golden age of television?
It's a golden age of television. I think it's a golden age of television. I'm not a television historian or expert by any means. It's not, you know, it's not really the primary focus of my studies, my background. But it seems like from what I hear from all the people who love to talk about movies and television, there's a never ending supply of suggestions and recommendations. Say, oh, have you seen Mindhunter? You know, have you seen Black Mirror? You know, have you seen Mozart in the Jungle, etc.
A few years ago, Steven Spielberg, Martin Scorsese, and you and I follow the movie industry very closely, both warned that there might be a day when people would stop going to movies in the theater. Remember that?
I do.
What do you think of that? Were those predictions too dire?
They were. I think they suggested that movies would become a premium kind of experience, like going to the ballet. Right. You'd pay a huge amount of money, and there would be limited engagements in theaters that provided these creature comforts, you know, the kinds of things that now we've grown accustomed to in town at Marcus Cinemas with the Dream Loungers as one kind of example. But a kind of counterpoint to that position that they took is the advent of a company like MoviePass, mm-hmm. where you pay a flat rate, a monthly fee, and can see pretty much unlimited movies. Obviously, exhibitors hate this and are desperate to, you know, try to avoid letting their consumers come to a conclusion that, oh, well, I only pay a couple of bucks each time I see a movie when it averages out. And if they get used to that, so to speak, that they won't pay premium prices to go see something in the theater. They'll simply wait for it to be available to watch in their own home.
Are movie studios nervous though about this?
I don't know where the studios stand on this. I know exhibitors are the most, you know, adamantly opposed when you have chains like AMC that are trying to do whatever they can. At one point, there was even a consideration to not accept Discover Card or MasterCard or I think it was MasterCard that MoviePass was using. And that, I just don't know that that's going to work. This notion of kind of a flat fee and then go see what you want, it's interesting because that's in the brick and mortar world, but it's akin to how we currently pay for streaming services. You have a big smorgasbord of stuff that you can choose from.
Mm-hmm. how do you mentioned Netflix is kind of like a film studio. Mm-hmm. Are they eligible, their films, for Oscar competition? We're hearing some stuff about the Meyerowitz stories, maybe mm-hmm. having some Oscar legs. Mm-hmm. How does that work? Are they in this competition with the others?
Well, they are. I mean, yes, they, as long as the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences rules are abided, then the film is eligible. So if it plays theatrically in New York or Los Angeles for at least 1 week in a theater, then it could be in consideration for a possible Oscar nomination. We saw that happen last year with Manchester by the Sea. Mm-hmm.
Are you confident or not? The last couple of years, a little bit box office dip. We've mm-hmm. seen summer overall. There's some really good films out there that you mm-hmm. and I go to, but mm-hmm. it doesn't seem like people go to them. Are they going to come out of this slump, do you think, or is there too much sequel content? What is your theory about this?
Yeah, I think that it's hard to track or predict something that, you know, is related to an industry that's been around for over a century. And so, I'm as interested as anyone else in seeing whether or not people, I prefer to go and watch a movie in the theater when it's new. But I know that I'm not the only person who likes that, but neither does everyone want that. They would just as soon, when I think Soderbergh released Bubble, you might remember that mm-hmm. film Bubble, it was available on physical media, DVD, streaming on Amazon, and in a dozen cities theatrically all on the same day, all on the very same day. And a lot of other, Soderbergh's own competitors, M. Night Shyamalan, spoke against that and did not think that was a good idea and thought it would bode ill for the industry and for content creators.
What happens in a studio, Greg, when, let me just throw a film out like Suburbicon, which you and I saw, bad film, horrible film, it bombed at the box office, the trailer looked good, it was kind of a Coen Brothers thing, but not anywhere close to that good.
Right.
How does a studio deal with a screw-up like that?
Suburbicon, it feels like it just missed its moment.
Yes.
Because if it was based on a script that had been written years ago and you kind of were wondering about the timing of its release, it was a case where clearly those folks and probably George Clooney himself knew that maybe it wasn't all there. And it was, I think a studio has to, just as they've done for decades, rely on a few profit-making movies, their tentpole movies, to shore up the ones that take these big losses and end up in the red.
Do you think HBO and Showtime and some of these companies have done very well at the Emmys because they're able to put more daring content on, or what do you think's going on?
That's part of it. I think that's a huge part of it. And I, again, not a television expert, but I remember reading an interview with David Chase, and he said it was the best thing that ever happened to him that The Sopranos was not picked up by a network, because once it was on HBO and he was able to do the things that would be more typical of an R-rated film, it changed the dynamic.
Yeah. Well, we here at PBS are glad that NBC passed on Downton Abbey, too.
Right.
That was a nice break.
Yes.
Let's move to your film reviewing. You write for the High Plains Reader.
Do.
I do film reviews for Prairie Public on the radio side, but you write yours out.
Yes.
And tell me what goes into that, the research, what you're looking for, maybe how you watch a film differently than the normal film goer might watch a film.
Well, I love writing at HPR because the editors and co-owners, Raul Gomez, have given me over the last 20 years now a wide berth to choose the film that I'm going to write about. When our friend Roger Moore, whose reviews are often published, nationwide through McClatchy Services and in the Orlando Sentinel, he said there's a difference between a film critic and a film reviewer, and he made a good point about that. He has to try to indicate to a reader in just a few paragraphs whether the film's worth their money. And he said the luxury that I have as a film critic is that I'm writing an essay on a movie. It doesn't really matter. I'm not advocating necessarily that a person should go and see something. In fact, I get to review movies that in some instances aren't even playing theatrically, although I try to make sure that I'm reviewing something that had just opened within that week or is just streaming, just recently streaming. And so I obviously I read about film every day. I watch a theatrical feature every day. And so that kind of the background accumulation of having seen, like, as you know, and you do yourself, having seen many, many movies helps a lot. Mm-hmm. I don't take notes during the screening.
I don't either.
I know some, I have reviewer friends who have done that, and that's been their practice. Because I'm going with the general public, I don't think it's appropriate to turn on a little flashlight or anything like that. So I wait until, you know, when I've finished the film, I almost immediately go in front of a computer so I can formulate thoughts, notes, and outline, even if I'm not going to write the whole thing right then. I try to do it as close to when I saw the film as possible so I don't forget some of the important things I want to say.
What are key things you're looking for, though, that are giveaways that, you know, you and I both know how films are edited, mm-hmm. how they're constructed? What are you, mm-hmm. what are you looking for that maybe might yeah. not get through to average film
well,
goers?
I think, you know, the average film goer sees movies for the same reason that we do. We like certain filmmakers, but just as much we like certain actors and performers, and we're interested in what they might do with the role. And so that's, you know, I don't want to take a position that I'm a film snob, even though I feel like I do gravitate.
You've studied it, right?
Towards films that are, that you would call art house cinema, right? The Fargo Theater is the only independent first run movie house in our community. And so we have a chance to go see, you know, international non-English language films, even documentaries there at a rate that you would simply not be afforded by going to the stuff at the Marcus, mm-hmm. that's just released primarily through the main studios, big studios.
How do you respond when someone says that you are a film snob?
Yeah.
You don't know what you're talking about. I mean, I run into this with my in-laws. They say you watch weird films. What's
right.
up with you? You know.
Yeah, it's fun.
How do you dance that line?
Well, I love reception theory, right? So everybody is entitled to their opinion when it comes to something subjective like a piece of art. And if you consider, you know, film art as well as commerce, then I may enjoy engaging someone in that conversation, mm-hmm. and say, well, tell me. Why don't you tell me what it was that I got wrong, or that you thought I was off the mark about? And I have, over the years, received any number of letters, personally to me or addressed to the editor of the HPR, saying, you know, you missed the boat. You weren't on the money. You were wrong. And I've received probably an equal number, which is, you know, smallish, of people who say, wow, that was, you know, thanks for sharing that review. It echoed my thoughts or whatever.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about the cataclysmic event of Harvey Weinstein, which has hit the industry, Kevin Spacey. What is the long-term impact, do you think, that this will have on the film TV industry?
Well, I hope it's a watershed moment. Mm-hmm. I think it's an opportunity to begin the difficult and necessary change to a culture that so many people claimed to be blindsided by, with the exception of the women who had experienced this as an all too real and regular part of their attempts to, you know, get through a working day. And so I think if we can see the studios get behind the hiring of more women producers and directors, it's still a terrifically small, mm-hmm. you know, horrifically small number of feature theatrical films that are directed by women that get released. You know, each year, Amy Tobin and other film writers will publish the lists, the results of how many films are being directed by women released through major studios, and it's always a shockingly small number. Mm-hmm. And I think hopefully that will start to change. I mean, obviously Patty Jenkins had a huge success this year.
Greta Gerwig, Lady
and
Bird.
Greta Gerwig's Lady Bird has been a you know, an absolute critical juggernaut. And I think you know, next year Ava DuVernay's A Wrinkle in Time, you know, has an opportunity to be a, you know, kind of carry the flag for Disney. Mm-hmm. When so much of the content tends to be demographically targeted towards young men. And I think that's another place where the change can begin.
Got about a minute left. What are your top three or four films of 2017
so far, even though we have
a few more to see, don't we?
We do. There's a number that are in the pipeline that will get here, hopefully, you know, sooner rather than later. But I certainly love The Florida Project. I thought it was tremendous and have always been a fan of Willem Dafoe. And maybe this will be...
Well, he's sweeping the Critics Awards.
He's sweeping the Critics Awards. It looks like a nomination
looks like
for him
it.
And
looks
a,
like a, win.
A possible win.
Yeah, we're calling
and
it
wouldn't,
right here.
Wouldn't, there you go. Willem Dafoe and The Florida Project. But the entire... Even the non-actors and first-time actors are just as important and maybe more important as central characters in that film than his supporting role. But I love that film. I loved a film called Lady Macbeth. I don't know if you've seen that one yet, William Oldroyd's movie. It was it's dark and terrifying, and I found it feminist, and the lead performance is absolutely fantastic.
We are out of time. I know we could talk more quickly. If people want more information about your departments at Concordia, where can they go?
You can go to concordiacollege.edu, cord.edu. We'll take you to the main website, and then there's a search bar, and you can look me up there.
Okay, Greg, thanks.
Thank you very much.
We'll see you at the Fargo Film Festival. Greg Carlson has been my guest. We're from Concordia College. Stay tuned for more.
The duo calling themselves Lines and Notes is made up of Terry Mono, who teaches music in the Minnesota State University Moorhead's School of Performing Arts, and Kevin Zepper, who teaches in the MSUM English Department. Each of Mono's musical compositions is enhanced with Zepper's poetry. Together, their music and poetry create a whole new mood and tone for a particular arrangement.
She floats through the universe coffee hut and orders a tall, dark cup of twilight. A Mercury comet carries her to the beach by the bay. She spreads her shawl on the ground where grass and sand blur. It's early morning, her favorite time, when the fiery yellow sun and shy, coy moon exchange glances in the pale iris sky. She sips the spangled twilight slow, pausing when she's connecting with something, as she does in the morning. The ocean air rolling in from a point where the only land is underneath deep water cools her face, dissipates the remaining steam from her open cup, fluttering breath from a blue mother. For her, all of the elements in her life melt like a sandcastle. Magic surrounds her. She warms her hands in the wax cup, feels the honeycomb dimples on the amber wrap holder, savoring each swallow down to the bitter brown. In this moment, the sky clock winds down and balance regenerates. After she empties her cup, she gazes into the bottom. Tiny stars shimmer among earthy dregs.
Well, that's all we have on Prairie Pulse for this week. But as always, thanks for watching.
Funding for Minnesota Legacy programs are provided by a grant from the Minnesota Arts and Cultural Heritage Fund, with money from the vote of the people of Minnesota on November 4th, 2008, and by the members of Prairie Public.